Father, we thank you and we bless you, God of heaven. To you, Holy Father, be all the glory and all the honor for what has happened so far in the service. It's been awesome. Jehovah, we thank you. We bless you. So grateful, Father God, for this opportunity, Father God, to share fellowship with you and with each other. My God, thank you for praise and worship. Thank you for prayers. Thank you for utterance. Thank you for great testimonies or confirmation of prayers that were prayed night vigil and, of course, being prayed as well yesterday. Thank you, Father, for the ministry that is happening in Kingdom Gospel Church, the city of the Lord God himself, where our walls are salvation and our gates praise. Thank you for this great house you have raised for yourself to do your will, to do your bidding, to proclaim and publish and preach Christ, Jesus, as the Savior all over the world. Thank you and we bless you for the service. We just give you praise as we come to this hour. Lord, our hearts are open, our ears are open to hear you. Lord, speak to us, for we are listening. We know, God of heaven, that your word will always do us good. It will lighten our paths. It will illuminate our ways, oh God. It will open our eyes and above all shine your light so that there's no darkness in any area of our lives in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus, so that we shall not perish like others out of ignorance or lack of knowledge. Thank you for knowledge, for understanding, and wisdom coming from the word, even as we hear you this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord, and we bless you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen and amen. A very good afternoon to everybody who's on the call right now and those that will hear the word of the Lord later on demand through social media. We bless God for your lives, wherever you are, whatever time zone, time frame, culture, continent. We just thank God for heaven and we bless you in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. This is Kingdom Gospel Church, the city of the Lord, where our walls are salvation and our gates praise. We thank you for joining with us this afternoon to hear the word of the Lord. What can we do without the word? Nothing. In fact, the Bible says that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. And I pray that you will receive yours, take your portion of this world, so that you will live by the word of God in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you. By the grace of God, I want to return us to a message that the Lord spoke to us a while back. He's brought it back to my spirit for me to emphasize again that there's an enemy out there who's playing games with people's souls and destinies and lives and marriages and children or child or business or career. There's an enemy who's playing games with people. And sadly, people of God. And God wants us to be aware of this game and to beat the enemy at his game. And so the topic for today is beating the enemy at his game. It's going to be part one today because we won't finish everything. But the Lord is expanding the word in my heart, even as I listen to him and I go back to refresh my spirit with the word and with the notes. So it's part one of beating the enemy at his game. We begin in the Gospel of John, John chapter 10, verse number 10. I will read from my New King James Version of the Holy Bible. In John 10:10, you read this: "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy." Mm-hmm. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. That is the goal of the enemy, the thief. That is the object of the enemy. Amen. He may come as a friend. He may come as somebody wants to do good. He may come in many disguises. Oh, the shukankode tongue, amen. The clothing as though he's a sheep, or really he's a wolf, amen. A wolf, amen. But with the sweet talks and sweet lyrics that he has, he may come with on the back of charity or generosity. The thief does not come to no, but I mean, he's not the thief. He's not going to come to say, "I am a thief. I come to steal from you." No, it's not going to come like that. The thief is not going to come to say, "Oh, I'm a thief, I come to kill you." Or, "I'm a thief, I come to destroy you." No, he will come with the best of disguises. He will come with the most suitable disguise to trick you. And that itself is part of the game. To win your confidence, to win your trust. And then, God forbid, they strike. If thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. "I have come that they may have life," this is the Lord Jesus Christ speaking, "and that they may have it more abundantly." And so where the enemy, the thief, should I say, wants to steal, kill, and destroy, Jesus has come that you may have that life and to have it even more abundant, amen, blessed life, a radically blessed life in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The church, I pray we listen to the Lord this afternoon as he instructs us in the way we should go to beat the enemy at his game. The enemy has a game, a terrible, wicked, and evil game, to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So John the Apostle gives us what I consider the end result of the enemy's game. Okay? That is what he wants to do. That is what he wants to achieve. To kill, to destroy. Amen? To steal, kill, and destroy. The family, the marriage, the union, that child or children. To kill, to steal, kill, and destroy. Your vision, your mission, your business, your career. To steal, kill, and destroy. Your ministry. And whatever it is that God has blessed you with in life. So John gives us what I consider the end result of this game, the enemy's game, which is to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Your power, your wisdom, everything that makes you who you are. To even steal and kill and destroy your identity. Amen. The enemy is out to steal, kill, and destroy anything and everything that belongs to us and that remotely resembles God in us. He hates God, and so he hates us. That is why the Apostle Peter tells us in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, he says to us, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And I pray in Jesus' name that the enemy will not be able to devour us or devour our children, our dreams, our passions, our marriages, our union, our affection, our faith, our money, our career, everything. About us, the enemy shall not be able to seek to destroy us in the mighty name of, devour us in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion. He is not a roaring lion. He's walking about like, he's an imitation of a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Amen. Well, that will not be us in Jesus' name. And Paul, the Apostle Paul, in 2 Corinthians 2:11, says this to us. He says, for us, amen, in other words, what he's saying to us, says, let Satan take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. What is he saying? Peter began by saying, be sober, be vigilant. And Paul is saying, lest Satan, who is the enemy, should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. And this is the essence of this message, that we become aware that we are not ignorant of the devices of the enemy. What are the devices of the enemy? What devices mean? His tricks, his stratagems, his maneuvers, his manipulations, his expedients, his ruses, his tricks, his, you know, the things he does. So the enemy's devices is not so much as a spear or arrow or a gun or a machete. It means his tricks, you know, the lies, thank you, the hypocrisy, the pretenses, amen, gaining your trust so that he may attack you. So we need to be vigilant. We need to be sober, to be vigilant, lest Satan will take advantage of us, amen, for we should not be ignorant or unaware of his tricks, his stratagems, his maneuvers, his manipulations, his expedients, his ruses, amen, and every way he comes. We should be sober, we should be vigilant, lest, and I love the way these two scriptures fuses together. But sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the enemy, that is the devil, walks about like a roaring lion seeking to devour, lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. So regardless of the warnings of these apostles, Peter and Paul, many today, sadly, I must say, believers at that matter, are still completely ignorant of the enemy's game. And so the enemy is having a field day with some people. You know, lately the enemy has been attacking my mind, attacking me, in a particular area concerning relationship and certain people and all of this. But I understand. And so when I see this sign, I know what to do and how to deal with it. And everyone who is not aware or ignorant of it, amen, will fall victim. Many have gone into depression, into hopelessness, giving up on good and godly relationships that God gave to them to bless them. Many have given up and lost precious people in their life, lost precious, valuable things in their life, blessings, because they didn't understand that behind that game is an enemy. Oh, church, hear God this afternoon. Behind, it is not the man or the woman, not the people. There's an enemy behind. Amen. Because nothing just happens. Look around you, the whole world. It didn't just happen. In the beginning, God spoke. Amen. The sun, the moon, the stars. He spoke the trees. He spoke the waters. He spoke everything. So nothing just happens. There's the power behind it. The good and godly is God. The evil and wicked is Satan the devil. Who is the God, the small g, amen, of the world system. The world system. The system of darkness and the actors and players within that system. The principalities, the powers, the rulers of this darkness of this age, the host of spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places. But guess what, people of God, you and I are one with Christ. We have victory. Because Colossians 2 says he made a public spectacle of them. He defeated them. He triumphed over them. And so you and I, as co-heirs with Christ, in him, we have this victory. And we must enforce the victory so that the enemy cannot play his idiotic and silly games with any of us in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me shout a big amen, somebody. So we must be aware. We must not be ignorant of the devices, meaning the tricks, the stratagems, the ruses, the maneuvers, the manipulations, and the experience of the enemy. Amen? But sadly, some of us are falling in. But people of God, let's unpack this. Amen? Let me say to brethren, people of God, please be on the lookout. The enemy is after you and after your stuff. Oh, man of God, look out, be on the lookout. The enemy is after your marriage and your house and your ministry. Oh, woman of God, be on the lookout. The enemy is after your wife, after your husband, should I say, I beg your pardon, after your child or children, and after your house. Be on the lookout. Amen. And if you look at the people of God, your life, the stability and the significance of your life is about the relationship, whether it's marriage, whether it's friends, whether it's people. Amen. And the things that you do to make life good, your work, your business, all of these areas, the enemy will try to trick you. Amen. Manipulate you and walk you out of what is supposed to be a blessing for you for your whole life and people who are depending on you. Many have lost marriages, lost children, lost good and godly relationships, lost ministries because the enemy came and tricked them. The enemy came and played this game, and at the end, the enemy was able to steal, kill, and destroy that vision, that dream, that ministry, that marriage, that house. Amen. And I pray that will not be our portion in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, church, let's be vigilant. Let's be sober. Let the enemy will take us on our way. And that is why the Lord will have me come back again on this message, beating the enemy at his game. First of all, amen. What's this game? What is this game? First, what is game and what is, and really, who is the enemy? What is game? Who is the enemy and what is the enemy's game? Let's try and unpack these, people of God. What is game? Game simply is something played for fun. For example, an activity that people participate in together or on their own for fun. I mean, it's simple. It's innocent. A game of sport, like a game of football, table tennis, a game of soccer, a game of lawn tennis, a game of rugby, a game of, you name it, for fun. That people do it themselves, or a game of card games where you play Monopoly, you know, board games, cards, it's a game. It's for fun, for enjoyment, for pleasure. You can play by a game of Scrabble, 2 or 3 people playing Scrabble. Amen. You know, whatever it is, it's just a game. However, the word game also means a way of behaving that is aimed at manipulating people or trying to deceive them. For example, a strategy, an activity, or a behavior that is questionable. And so game has the positive aspects of it, which is the innocent one to play something for sport, table tennis, football, soccer, you know, card, board game, cards, or whatever you call it, you know, soccer. That's innocent. But there's the game that we are looking at today, which is a way of behaving that is aimed behavior, remember, of at manipulating people or trying to deceive them. In for example, a strategy, an activity, or a behavior that is questionable. Amen. And is often illegal. Amen. A game in this context also means to manipulate something cunningly. E.g., for example, to manipulate something cunningly in order to advance yourself, okay, or attain your goals in an underhanded, meaning deceitful, dishonest, sneaky, sly, or secretive manner. Amen. So you come to somebody, you ask them questions. No, it's not to advance their cause or their mission, but for you to use their information to go and help yourself. Then you come deceitfully to know what this person has, to know what the information they have, and then you go and tell other people to so that they can advance or promote you. This happens a lot of times in the workplace. People scheming, manipulating so that they will have the upper hand. Oh, that is the game. That is the game the enemy and his evil agents play everywhere, everywhere. So then, who is the enemy? Who is the enemy? Well, the dictionary that I have defines the enemy as a person who is actively opposed or hostile to someone or something. Someone that is hostile, is opposite. Amen. It's like Russia and Ukraine, a hostile nation or its armed forces. You know, there's hostility started by Russia against Ukraine. That is a good example. So Russia is enemy to Ukraine. And Ukraine concerns Russia, enemy to them. Amen. Russia consider Ukraine enemy to them as well. So both sides consider each other enemies. Particularly in the time of war, as we see even right now between Russia and Ukraine. Synonyms of the word enemy are foe, adversary. That word is in the Bible. Opponent, rival, challenger, competitor, nemesis, antagonist, and combatant. And so you see, you've heard the word adversary today. Amen. Because Apostle Peter talks about adversary. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, meaning your enemy. So, Church of God, we have a common enemy. But who is this enemy? Amen. Who is he? Is it your, okay, there's a disagreement, a quarrel between the husband and the wife. Is the wife the enemy, or is the husband the enemy to the wife, or the wife enemy to the husband? Oh, at home, in the one family, parents, you know, it's like war between the child and our children. Who is the enemy there? The child to the, or children to the parents, or the parents to the child? Who is the enemy? And let me use the one of husband and wife. It's part of the deal. We'll have our moments where we disagree, where we'll exchange harsh words and all of that. There is no guarantee it will happen. In fact, it is foolish to say that you live in a relationship, in a house, or in a union with another human being like you, man, or you know, to the woman, woman to the man, as God will have us do it. You know, man and woman in the relationship union. It'd be foolish to think, oh, all through the many years you're going to be together. 10 years, 15, 20, 35, 50 years, you won't have a moment of argument. I think it's impossible. When it happens, who is the enemy in that relationship, in that context? Is it the man to the woman or the woman to the man? Your own child, for example, you disagree over education, over choices, all kinds of things. You disagree how they're doing, how they have their behavior, maybe keeping lateness, maybe not doing their homework, maybe their rooms are not tidy. You disagree. So is the parent the enemy to the child or child the enemy to the parents? Who really is the enemy? Amen. I know the definition of the enemy. Sorry, but by the dictionary, it points to a person or people. Yes, let's go back, because the dictionary defines the enemy as a person who is hostile, who is opposed to another person, or a nation like Russia is hostile to Ukraine. Amen. But when it comes to the things of the kingdom, and for us in Christianity, is it the person that is the enemy? Amen. Is it the person? Remember, even as Christians, yes, people who know God, anointed pastors, ministers of God. We have challenges for people. Your spouse, your husband, or your wife for the woman, or for the man, or your husband for the woman, your wife for the man, your child or children for both of them, pastors or ministers or bishops, well, you know, whatever title you go by, or you're just a believer, you know. Listen, it happens to all of us. Well, but in that situation, who is the enemy? If the enemy is trying to steal, kill, and destroy the object of his game, so who is the enemy? Well, the dictionary says it's a person. Really? Is it a person? Let me say, for us, people of God, amen, kingdom people, our common enemy is not a person, but a fallen angel called Satan. So it is important that we know who the enemy is. So, oh man of God and oh woman of God, in that moment as you are shouting and exchanging harsh words, listen, your wife is not the enemy, oh man of God. Your oh woman of God, your husband is not the enemy. There's an enemy who's trying to come in between two of you. He's a fallen angel that we call Satan, the devil, Satan, the diabolic, Diabolos. He's the adversary. Amen. I think Pastor Apostle Peter was very specific. Amen. Sorry, Apostle Paul. Very specific. 2 Corinthians 2:11, he says, "Lest Satan take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices." It's a fallen archangel. There was three archangels up in heaven. Michael, Gabriel, and who? Lucifer. So upon his fall, there was a change of identity. From the angel of light became angel of darkness. Amen. And his name, Satan, the adversary, the accuser of the brethren. Let's go to Matthew 16, 21 to 23. And I hope, people of God, you are receiving something from the Lord this afternoon. Amen. And so when you go to your office, as they are misbehaving and treating you unfairly, they are not the enemy. There's a power behind it, because nothing just happens. Amen. The believer goes to work. I step into the office, everybody keeps quiet. Before you came in, they were talking and chatting. As soon as you show, they kept quiet. You wonder, what have I done? Hallelujah. Somebody can relate to what I'm saying. Somebody, you go up to a store, to a shop, to buy, you go in there, you are looking at the things to buy, you pick them, you come to pay at the till or to the cashier, two or three people before you, everybody's happy, they're paying and going, and the cashier is giving. When is your turn, the attitude of the cashier changes. As I said, they want to see you in the store, in the shop. What did you do? Nothing. There's an enemy behind it. There's a power behind it. His name is Satan the devil. Amen. So all you need to do, people of God, is pray for them. Father, show them mercy. Pray for yourself. Give me the fortitude and the strength of character by the Holy Spirit to endure and to bear. And pray for them. And God will strengthen you. He will release an abundance of grace upon you. No matter what they do, you will not be affected in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody needs to hear that. So people of God, who is the enemy? Let's go to Matthew chapter 16, 21 to 23. I promise I won't be too long now, amen. Matthew 16, 21 to 23. And you will see the Lord himself, you know, unveil to us who the enemy is. Hallelujah. In Matthew 16, verse 21 to 23, you read this in your Bibles. From that time, Jesus began to show to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him in verse 22, saying, "Far be from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." But he turned and said to Peter, But he spoke to who? Satan. Get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. Oh, can I ask you, Church of God, is Peter Satan? I'm sure you are shouting, no, 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 Peter is not Satan. Correct. Where did Satan come from then? I thought Peter was just talking to Jesus. Well, Peter is in the flesh, human being like us. Jesus is in the flesh, human being like us. But Satan is not in the flesh because he's a spirit. And so there are two human beings talking, Jesus the Christ and Peter, amen, the big rock. But then Jesus is not just, he's turned and said to Peter, but he's actually addressing Satan. Church, nothing just happens. Oh, man of God, woman of God, children of God, nothing just happens. There is always another voice. There's always another hand. There's always a third party. And so if we are not aware, you will think Peter is the enemy. Peter is not the enemy. Hallelujah. Let's back up. The Bible says from that time, what time? What time? Oh, let's go back to what Jesus meant by from that time. Let's take it from verse number 13, if you will, people of God. In verse 13, same chapter, Matthew 16, we read from 21 to 23. Let's take it from 13 quickly. And from the Bible says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked the disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Who do people say I am? So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others say Jeremiah, one of the prophets. But he said to them, I won't bother with the world. I won't bother with these people. But who, you, my disciples, who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are the Christ, Son of the living God. And remember, he's with his disciples, 12 of them. 11 had no answer. One had an answer. And his answer was spot on. Jesus answered in verse 17 and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, meaning Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed it to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter. You know me, so I know you. I pray, people of God, that as you know God, may God know you in Jesus' name and begin to decree and declare your destiny, even to you in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus. Okay, pray. People, there's a message here. Know your God. The more you know him, the more he will know you. And the more he will put you and speak you, not just speak you into your destiny. And I also say to you that you are Peter. And on this rock, this revelation, I will build my church. So the church of God is built on those who know him, not on those who don't know him, who are playing games. And the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. It was the church. And you are in the church, meaning the gates of Hades shall not prevail against you. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, meaning I will give you the authority of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. It is from this time that Jesus is talking about. Then he commanded his disciples that they should tell no one who he. He commanded his disciples that they should tell no one that he was Jesus the Christ. So from that time, amen, have the disciples now know who he was or he is to them at the time. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples, amen, from verse 21, that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. This verse 21 captures everything Jesus came to do. He was born to die and to be raised from the dead. In so doing, pay the price so that all of humanity can be bought back to God by his precious blood. And so in verse 21, from that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things and be crucified. Amen. And then resurrect the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Amen. Saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you. What Peter was saying, you will not go to Jerusalem, you will not fulfill your mission, you will not be crucified, and there will be no resurrection. Well, if there was not going to be crucifixion, resurrection, then surely we are all going to remain in our sin because there's no more salvation. His mission was to bring salvation. And then guess what? It wasn't Peter speaking because Jesus turned to Peter, but he spoke to Satan and rebuked Satan. Get behind me, Satan. You are in my past. Behind me is past. You are in the sins of the world. You are in the sins of the world. You are in the captivity of the world. You are in the bondage of the world. You are in the darkness that is the world. But I have come to liberate them. I have come to set them free, to come to make them free, and they may have a future and a hope. And so what Peter was doing, not him really, the Satan, the enemy, through Peter, was trying to talk Jesus out of his mission. Well, if his mission is aborted, then there will be no church today. There will be no preaching this Sunday afternoon. There will be no praise and worship. None of us will be in Christ. And so Jesus, the Christ, turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. Is Peter, was Peter Satan? The answer is no. Amen. This is the game that the enemy is playing. He played it even with our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we must learn to beat the enemy at his game. And so what did Jesus do? He exposed the enemy for who he is. Get behind me, Satan. Remember, he's already blessed Peter. You know this revelation you have, Simon, son of Jonah, it is not from anybody but from the Father. You are connected to heaven. You're hearing from heaven. I've not even told you who I am, but you already know. Because you know, and you are this, in the, and you have this revelation, upon this I will build my church, and the enemy, the gates of Hades, and you, I will give you the authority of the kingdom, the keys of the kingdom, because you know me. And so those who know him as he really is will walk in his authority. Not those who are playing games and pretending that they know him, but are so far from him. I wonder how close you are and how close I am to the Lord on this Sunday afternoon as we preach this message. I hope and I pray that you are as close as is possible so that you too, like Peter, will have the keys and the authority of the kingdom so that whatever you speak on earth on his behalf, he will honor it in heaven, and so be it. Whatever you allow, he will allow it. Whatever you disallow, he will disallow, because he's giving you the keys, the authority of the kingdom, because you know him like Peter did at that time. From that time, he began to teach them and to tell them, listen, people, listen, disciples, I'm going to go to Jerusalem, I'm going to suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, be crucified, and then be raised the third day. And Peter, the very same man who got the revelation, the question is, how is it that Peter, who knew him, excuse me, is not telling him something completely different? How? How? Ask yourself that question, people of God. How is it that Peter, who had this almighty revelation of who Jesus the Christ is and was and will ever be, you know, is not taking him aside? Because very possibly, people of God, in your moment of spirituality, very possible, it happens to a lot of people. God gives you a word of prophecy and you begin to unspot on, and then the next thing, you are beginning to prophesy things that are completely different, because the enemy will exploit you and take over and begin to say things that God never sent you to say. So we must be careful. In the moment of high spirituality, in God, by the Holy Spirit, you can say things spot on. And then the next day or the next minute, I heard a story of a man of God, you know, somewhere in West Africa. God gave a word to this man of God. It was spot on. Was spot on, maybe a paragraph or two, not even half a page of an A4. Well, the next time when he prophesied, it was 7 pages of A4. 7 pages. Jehovah help us. Church, I pray that we'll not fall into the trap, amen, of trying to do things God never sent us to do, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a lot of, thus saith the Lord, God never said anything because we feel that is what God is saying. You know, we have to be very, very careful to balance it. Amen. Not to bring flesh into the spirituality that God desires for us to walk in. But back to the text. Get behind me, Satan. Peter is not Satan. Yet the Lord is addressing Satan. But he's speaking to Peter. He said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. And then he exposes something that the Lord taught me again. Amen. You are an offense to me. For you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. There you go. There are things of God and things of men. I recently preached a three-part message of the right pursuits. And in that text, in Matthew chapter 6, the Lord said, we pursue that is man now. You cannot serve God and mammon. And the pursuits of those who are serving mammon, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? And what shall we put on? What shall we wear? The clothes. Flesh you cannot, outside of God. And then God says, seek ye first the kingdom and my righteousness. And all this is which the churches that are seeking after shall be added unto you. And so we see it here again in Matthew 16, 23. Jesus is saying, you are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God. The kingdom is righteousness, but you are mindful of the things of men, meaning the things of mammon, which are completely opposite to the things of God. And so there's a clash, a conflict of two kingdoms. Satan is the ruler of the kingdom of man, or mammon. Amen? And God is the ruler of the kingdom of God. Obviously, is the king. You are an offense to me because you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of mammon, or the things of men. Amen. And so what the enemy will try to do is trick you out of the things of God, the holiness, and tell you everybody's doing it, you too can compromise. The righteousness, it doesn't matter. You don't have to be. You too can. Amen. Your study of the word of God, your attending church, your tithing, amen, your offerings. He will give you 1,001 reasons not to obey God or flow with God or follow God, because he's not mindful of the things of God. Rather, the things of man, which is the things of pleasure of the flesh. Oh, you can do it. Take a break. Everybody's doing it. Come on. God would not mind. Remember how he tricked Eve in the garden. Genesis 3, verses 1 to 8. Oh, Eve did have an idea or have instruction. Eve, oh, that was from not God of heaven. I love you. Thank you, Jehovah. I'm sure, people of God, you are following me. I hope you are following me. He's the same old Satan, the same old enemy. The tricks are the same. There's no new trick. It's a conversation. Did God really say? Yes, God said, leave me alone. And here's Peter, the big rock. Amen. Who already knows who Jesus is. All of a sudden, from the spirit, he's switching to the flesh. No, no, God. It won't happen to you. Far be from you. This shall not happen to you. But this is exactly why he came. This is salvation, redemption of souls, of all humanity. And so what we see here, people of God, lessons we learn is that when you are on a mission for God, oh, you don't have to be like Peter, a major disciple, you know, the apostle to after Jesus to lead the church. You don't have to be a pastor, an archbishop. It could be you, a housewife, amen, raising the next great man of God or as a child. For God, you are in a holy matrimony, honoring God as man and woman, and the enemy comes to attack you. They want to trick you. Amen. He's not mindful of the things of God. So he will try to trick you from the things of God. It could be on a job where you are working in integrity, upholding your dignity as a child of God, as a believer, and as a Christian who is fair and who is committed. But he's trying to trick you. You too can do the things that your colleagues are doing. It doesn't matter. You can tell a lie here. You can do this. You can scheme. You can manipulate so that you can be promoted. Meanwhile, God says in his word, promotion does not come from where? Amen. East, west, or south. But it comes from above. So God is able to promote one and depose another. He's able to depose one and promote another. And the enemy will try to trick you, take your mind out of what God has said in his word, that you are holding, that you are doing your life by. Because he's not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. He's only mindful to try and satisfy you, the pleasures and the wants. Amen. Try and satisfy the cravings and the lust of the flesh. Get behind me, Satan. And so Jesus is teaching us, here, people of God, when you come to know, you must put the enemy in his place. He's behind you. He's in your past. He's in your history. In those days when you were a sinner, when you were not saved, he was your Lord. He was the master, serving the pleasures of the mind, the carnal pleasures of the flesh, doing things that a lot of us, even all of us, are now ashamed of, according to the scriptures. But now you are born again. We must not let Satan be in our presence. Of course, not in the future. We must always tell him to get behind us, to go back to the past, when we were unbelievers, seeking after the pleasures of the flesh, when we're pursuing the lust of the eyes and trying to fulfill those lusts, when we were after, you know, the pride of life. All of those things, they are the past. Today, we are in the Christ, and so we are mindful of the things of God. Why are you here in this call listening to me? Because you are mindful of the things of God, to be in church, to be in the kingdom, to have an assembly where we've prayed, we worship, prophetic words have been spoken, and of course we're hearing the word of the Lord. You are mindful. So we must not allow the enemy any opening, we must not open any door to the enemy to come into our present life and to begin to play his game. This is how we beat the enemy at his game, when we confine him to the past, to our history, when I was an unbeliever, when I was a sinner, running from nightclub to nightclub and from women to women, when I was back in the past, doing the things of the world. Now I'm in the kingdom with an assignment from God and a purpose to fulfill, a destiny to fulfill. I am not opening any door to the enemy. So Satan, get behind me in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is how we beat the enemy at his game, not allow him any entrance into our current dialogue and conversation and communion and fellowship with the Lord in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." Remember, Satan is a fallen angel. Amen. The spirit is not in the flesh. How come Jesus is speaking audibly, vocally? The wind has ears. I've said it over and over again to Kingdom Gospel Church. I've said it. This is the city of the Lord. Amen. Where our words of salvation and our gifts of praise. I've said it many, many times. The wind has ears. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Amen. The wind has ears. Amen. And I pray that the things you say, oh God, the wind has ears. The wind, let the wind hear things that are good, constructive, progressive, to bless you, to bless your life, to bless your child or children, to bless your home, bless your husband, bless your wife, bless your ministry, bless your work, the works of your hand, bless your vision and your mission, bless every day that you, I wake up and I say, today, my day, is a day of making profit, a day of progress, a day of moving forward in fulfilling destiny, a day of prosperity. I decree it in Jesus' name. The wind has ears. And it shall be as you've spoken it. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as I prepare to close the people of God, Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." Amen. And remember the big answer that we said, Peter is not Satan. Yet in speaking to Satan, Jesus addressed, sorry, in speaking to Peter, beg your pardon, in speaking to Peter, Jesus addressed and rebuked Satan. "You are an offense to me. You are after the things of man, mammon, the flesh. But I am after and meant for the things of the kingdom." Church, this is serious. This is the enemy's game. Trying to steal Jesus' mission, his vision, the vision of saving the world, humanity. Remember, at this point, he's not been given the name that's above all names. And at the mention of his name, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. He's not been given that name just yet. It was upon resurrection God gave them that name. So his vision was trying, the enemy was trying to abort it. How? Through Peter, who was close to him. Some of the greatest pains we will ever bear, we'll ever go through, are from people who are closest to us. People who know us. Who divorces a man, his wife. Who divorces a woman, her husband. Closest. Your parents may know you, oh woman of God, because they raised you. But your husband knows you in a dimension your parents never knew you, because he's your husband. The intimacy you share with your husband, nobody else but your husband. Same thing for the man. Nobody else but your wife. I grew up in the home where my father had multiple wives, and all of this is big home. But my wife and I, we differ from that relationship because, oh, God of heaven, it's unique. But who divorces a woman? Who divorces a man? The child who goes completely in a different tangent, completely off track, brings shame and disgrace and pain to the family. So it's people closest to us that can sometimes be the source and the cause of pain. Peter had the revelation of the 12. Only him knew who he was. In the very same situation, the very same context, without even traveling, without even, not even another day, he's also now becoming the source that the enemy was trying to use to trick the Lord out of his vision or his mission or assignment to save all of humanity. Far be it from me, Lord. It shall not happen. You won't be crucified. You won't resurrect. What? If he didn't go to the cross, if he didn't resurrect, you and I will still be in our sins, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, as the apostle Paul wrote it for us. As I close it, people of God, thank you, Holy Father, for these words you've shared with us today. Not me, it's you, Lord. Let me tell us and remind us again that the enemy has a game. Amen. And the game is to manipulate people in order to deceive them through targeted and strategic activities, situations, or circumstances and people. The enemy's game is serious. It is not for fun, but intended to do serious damage and destruction to somebody or some people somewhere. Amen. The enemy has a game. The objective of that game, the end goal, is to kill, steal, and destroy. But the game is to manipulate people in order to deceive them through targeted and specific and strategic activities, situations, or circumstances, and through people like Peter. The enemy's game is serious. It is not for fun, people of God, because souls are at stake. The soul of all humanity was at stake when Satan was speaking through Peter to the Lord. Far be it from you. This shall not happen. What's not going to happen? Oh, I shouldn't go to Jerusalem. I shouldn't go through the torture and the beating and the scourging and the evil things that they're going to do to me. Oh, I should not be crucified and I should not resurrect. If that is not happening, Church of God, all of us will be back in the world in our sins. No hope of eternal destiny. I'm sure you can understand the seriousness of what was happening. The enemy's. And so the enemy would, just as he did with the Lord Jesus Christ, then he would come to you. He did it with Eve. Remember Eve and her husband, Adam. They had a home, amen, in the garden. But he came and spoke to Eve, tricked her. She was deceived. That's the enemy's game. What happened when they ate of that fruit? Two of them, the man and the woman. The woman and the man. Adam, Eve, Adam. Their both eyes were open. And they lost their innocence. Consequently, they lost the relationship with God, became carnal of flesh, and then they lost the God because God kicked them out. Can you see how serious it is? Church, like what Apostle Peter said to us, let us be what? Sober, vigilant, because our enemy, Satan, the devil, walks about looking like a roaring lion, seeking and looking for whom he may devour. And I pray he shall never, never be able to devour all of us, because as the Lord is speaking to us, he's exposing to us his game and his plans, so that we too can rise above him and confine him to our past, that he'll always be behind us in our previous history when we were in the world. in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you. I hope you prepare the word of God today. May this word be a plus for you, never a minus, in Jesus' name. May the Lord hold you to say, yes, you heard my word and you acted. And so the enemy cannot trick you, cannot manipulate you out of your destiny, out of where and what he has planned for you, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord bless you. Until next Sunday, remember, keep the faith. Jesus is Lord. The God of your salvation shall surely come true for you. In Jesus' name. Amen. And